Here we go. Off and running. These are dark days, difficult days, but we have to flip the script on all of this. So I will start out by emphasizing that the ego, which is really the voice of arrogance, which is our arrogance advising us that we must do the impossible, that we can do the impossible, which is to die. It's a spirit dying. We have to do that, and there's a way to do it, and we're trying. It's a process that we're supposedly undergoing. That this ego doesn't understand really anything at all, and except for contraction and fear, it understands fear. So it tries to get you into a fearful state any way it can. It's sort of like spiritually intuitive. It feels like, oh, you're not fearful. Let me help you. Let me help contract you. And it will sort of probe your belief, psyche and belief system to try and find a way to pull you down into a contracted, fearful state. Now, sometimes looking at the ego's defenses can be very fearful, but when we do that, we see, oh, I don't need to be afraid of that anymore. And then it actually helps us expand. But the ego, this is why dialogue really doesn't work. Because the ego's involved. It's better to be quiet. It's better to be quiet. It's better to make assertions. There's nothing to assertions. You're saying, I cannot deviate from the truth of my being. What God created can never be changed. I can never deviate from the truth of my being. It's impossible. You know, these are just absolute statements. So asserting absolutes is the way to push the ego aside, as it were. Affirming absolutes. The ego loves dialogue because it's an open door for the ego to start ratcheting you down into conflict, contention, fear, and all of that. When you're making an assertion, there's no conflict. I mean, you're just stating the truth. The truth is true. Truth is true. Now, I've said that we want to be able to bring this truth into sleeping dreams, not just the waking dreams here, but the sleeping dreams. And last night that happened to me. I was in this dream. And suddenly in this dream, I said, hey, truth doesn't have any opposite. There's some situation arose in the dream, and they're trying to get me to do something I don't want to do. And I said, hey, truth doesn't have any opposite. Oh, I know what it was. Yeah. Okay, I remember the dream. It's so bizarre, it's hard to remember dreams, isn't it? They're so bizarre. There was this large truck, and they wanted to drive it along the freeway, but they were trying to disguise it, what their load, what they were carrying, what they were about, and so they were going about this incredible fanciful disguise of this vehicle and the load it was carrying, and it was like some huge paper mache chicken. They made it into look like a gigantic chicken. And I was having to help them, and I saw all sorts of problems. I said, well, that's a problem. This is a problem. Because I'm a, sort of like a problem solver. And I was supposedly helping them do this. And then I realized that these are heroin worshippers. They were heroin worshippers. Heroin and heroin are quite similar, right? I mean, it's the old heroin worshippers. And they were desperate to disguise what they truly were. And so they had this very bizarre, like some gigantic chicken they were carrying along, and it was just ridiculous. And finally, I said, hey, you know, and I started backing away from helping them out. I said, this is ridiculous. You can't hide what you are. You really think you're going to be driving down the freeway, and this is a gigantic 50-foot long, 20-foot wide, 20-foot high chicken? And people are going to say, oh, yeah, sure, okay. They're just carrying that chicken down the road. I mean, it's completely absurd. I mean, we were tying everything off and keeping it from getting out of balance and doing all this ridiculous stuff. And of course, someone would look at that and say, what in the heck are they hiding? You know, it's like the most obvious thing possible. Well, they're heroine worshippers. They worship the goddess. They're goddess worshippers. This is what the world is. The world really worships. The goddess is just the nice face of the ego. It's the ego putting forward its supposedly best foot. Like, here's the good part of the ego. You know, this is where I'm only here to help you, help you do the impossible. I'm here to help you die. This is what the ego is telling, because we believe that only in dying can we find, will we ever find happiness. And I don't mean just the death of the body. I mean the death of spirit is what we're trying to do. So when the body dies, keep in mind that all needs that we see as the body are just being projected upon the body. The body's absolutely neutral. So when the body dies, a neutral body, the projections don't die. The mind is still wanting to project. So the mind will just project it on subtle bodies and keep projecting until it gets another, you know, gross body. So it, just the death of a body doesn't cure anything. That's actually a question I wanted to ask Trump. Do you believe in reincarnation? I mean, why don't they start asking some questions like, you know, do you believe in the Holy Spirit? Do you believe in reincarnation? Do you believe in Jesus is back? Questions like that. So let's give Trump a call here. I got his number on speed dial. Let's just give him a call here. Let's see if we can get through. That's busy. He's busy. Okay, well, he's got a lot of people calling him. I got through a couple times a day. Do you believe in reincarnation, right? Do you believe in eternal life? Start asking them some substantive questions. I mean, my gosh, it's amazing, the circus, right? I mean, nobody gets around to asking any real questions. I mean, what's your faith? You know, do you believe in the Holy Spirit? Do you believe there's the Word of God? Then do you believe in meditate? Have you meditated? Have you contemplated? Have you prayed? Do you pray? Do you center yourself? What are the techniques you use to center your mind in truth? How do you deal with the wow factor when you feel the wow? How do you deal with that? These are the questions that should be asked to anyone, right, that's running to be president. Instead, they avoid those questions like the plague. They say, well, we don't want anyone to ask us those questions, so...
Donald Trump, and I'm running for the presidency of the United States.
That's Trump
of America.
Right here. We got Trump here.
With your help and support, together we can make America truly great again.
Donald, you there?
Visit me on Twitter.
Do you believe
at Real Donald
in
Trump?
Reincarnation.
And check out
Hold
my
on.
Campaign website.
Let me ask a question.
Hard to get
a question in here.
Hope to see you
Donald.
On the campaign trail. We're going to do it.
Hey,
the mailbox is full and cannot accept
Donald,
any messages at this time.
Pick up the phone.
Goodbye.
Pick up the phone. Pick up. He wouldn't pick up. Miss that caller ID. He said, I don't want to answer this guy's questions. He's going to ask me real questions. You know, how do you deal with the wow? How do you deal with the wow? Come on. This is a question you're supposed to ask when you get the spiritual wow. Like, wow, I'm eternal. I can't deviate from the truth of what I am. I can't deviate from what I am one bit. I can't deviate from eternal life one bit. I am eternal life. I cannot deviate from eternal life one bit. You glimpse that. How do you deal with that? Wow. What's your way of dealing with that? Wow. You know, is it voluptuous women? Is that how you deal with it? Or you look at your gigantic hotel and say, wow, this is even greater than eternal life. Or, I mean, I don't know. Inquiring minds want to know. These jokers who are supposed to be asking questions, you know, they cannot, they don't ask those questions. Let's see if we can get through here again. Just get a lot of traffic there. Yeah, for some reason he won't take my call. He's busy. It's understandable. How do you deal with the wow? So how do we deal now? What we're going towards is being expansive. What the world does is it wants to contract you. So that you appear to be dead, so that you're among the dead. Now, as I walk around the world, it's for me, everyone looks dead. I'm among the dead here. Nobody's alive here. No one's living here at all. They're all the dead. Jesus called them the dead. At least we're told that. And we don't know how much influence Cyril of Alexandria had, but he had a lot of influence for sure. The patriarch of the Apostolic See of Alexandria. There was a lot of politics involved in the Gospels. If we really find the true story, we kind of scratch our heads probably, but it wouldn't be that surprising. So, fortunately, we have some teaching from the horse's mouth, as it were, modern teachings of Jesus, which we say, oh, that certainly sounds right, what he's saying. Yeah, and then... You know, basically, that's the new touchstone, and ultimately, the Holy Spirit is the ultimate touchstone. But Jesus has given some really great teachings, and this is my real message here. And there was a lot of, you know, a lot of mischief going on back then, a lot of intrigue. Now, keep in mind that Alexandria was, of course, an Egyptian city. And the Ptolemies just were put in there by Alexander the Great. But you have thousands of years of Egyptian history and religion there. And so you don't think that Egyptian religion was something that the Greeks weren't highly aware of? I mean, the Greeks were very inquisitive. And scholars and philosophers. And of course, the Ptolemies adopted the Egyptian religion. And or allowed them to put themselves up on the obelisks and religious statues, etc. They had themselves etched in all of that, so they embraced it. And the Egyptian religion, actually, if you go back and there've been books written about this of the technology that they actually had, the Ankh, the various things on the walls that you can see, they're very interesting instruments. Actually, they actually were aware of how to manipulate subtle energy in various ways. And they actually were focused on the atom, atomic energy, but in a different way than we're focused on it now. What they tried to do is they tried to change the structure of atoms, especially gold, the structure of atomic gold. And this, what is it, monatomic or something? They knocked out I don't know exactly what they did. There's books on it. I've read them. It was a while ago. What they did was they felt they could somehow raise the atomic vibration of gold through their temples and pyramids and various instruments that they had, and that by doing this, what they did is they got this white powder. And then what they did was they put this white powder into little cakes and ate these little cakes and little wafers, and they ate the wafers. And by gradually doing this, the Pharaoh was supposed to gain immortality. The priests, the Pharaoh, were supposed to gain immortality. It changed the atomic structure. They thought it changed the atomic structure of the body or of the spirit or whatever. So they had this religious science. Very much so. For thousands of years, they were very sophisticated in certain ways. So, lo and behold, here's Cyril of Alexandria, who basically won the debate about the creed, basic creed of Christianity that we've been living under for now about 1,500, 1,600 years, was saying that Christ is two separate natures, both man, human, and divine, but they're one, and also one. They're two separate natures, but also one. We talk about truth and lies both being true. You know, how do you make that true? It says, well, there's this hypostatic union that somehow mystically has them as one. And he was a huge proponent of the Eucharist, the sacramental wafer. Okay, And he said that wafer is the instrument whereby we, those who go into church, are hypostatically joined with the divine. Just the same way as Jesus, the perfect man, was hypostatically joined with Jesus, the perfect divinity. So it's that wafer that we eat that is supposedly affects this mystical hypostatic union. This was his philosophy. Now, he came, of course, from Alexandria, which was this, it was ancient. Well, Alexandria was actually built in 330 BC, around that time, 300 BC, maybe it was finished. But the Egyptian culture of thousands of years permeated the area, and so the Greeks most certainly would have known about these esoteric religions, practices of the Egyptians, which had to do with taking this white powder, which was gold transformed to the atomic structure of gold somehow, and putting that into wafers and then eating those wafers and believing that you gained eternal life from doing so. So it's not any surprise that this Egyptian custom then, that Cyril of Alexandria said, hey, you know, let's use this principle here and give, just like the Egyptian high priest had the capacity to change the atomic structure, supposedly, of gold, let's say that our priests, our high priests there, through ritual and command and various, you know, spiritual endowments they've gotten from the bishop and from Christ and Jesus and through the apostles, etc., that when they say that this is now the body of Christ, you know, this means that this wafer has the same hypostatic principle that they claim that Jesus have, these two natures hypostatically unionized as one, mystically as one, that cannot be explained how this is possible, that this wafer now, as being the body of Christ, also has that hypostatic union in it, and that when you eat this wafer, you will be going towards having an eternal body, eternal life, just exactly as the Egyptians believed that eating the monoamic gold in a wafer, that gradually they would get eternal life. So he was an emphatic proponent of the Eucharist, Cyril of Alexandria. And again, this is an Egyptian city steeped in Egyptian religion, stretching back thousands of years. This is something that they would have known about. And the Library of Alexandria, which is where Cyril studied, and he was, I think he may have been in charge of the library. They had papyrus text scrolls dating back thousands and thousands of years. This was the repository of all the ancient knowledge in this library. 700,000 scrolls. That's a lot of scrolls. And of course, Egyptians had been writing for thousands of years. So they had those documents in that library. They had the esoteric history of Egypt in that library. So there's no question that you have to say that someone who's so learned like Cyril of Alexandria would be very much aware of the Egyptian esoteric practices, and that these were grafted onto Christianity. Now, Jesus emphasized in the Gospels being prepared. He says, be prepared, don't be caught unaware, be prepared, be prepared, be prepared. This is very simple. The Passover meal that he was holding with his apostles, came from Jewish custom of eating unleavened bread, which came from having to flee Egypt. And the idea was that they had to flee so quickly, they didn't have time to even let the bread rise. You know, they just didn't have time to put the yeast in the bread. They just had to take this unleavened bread, no yeast in it. That's how quickly they had to flee. So it sort of implies a situation of urgency, I would say, that the eating of the Passover bread reminds us to be vigilant and to be urgent on our spiritual path. And of course, Jesus says that the body profiteth nothing, that the bread of life is, it came down for the world, is the teachings, and my word and my teachings. And that is what you should always be eating. But the Passover bread means do it with a sense of urgency. Don't be lax in your life. This is what Jesus is getting at. He said, constantly consider as the body of my teachings. It's my teachings that save. It's the truth that saves you. The flesh profiteth nothing. So yet do it in a way that it's like, you know, you don't know when calamity will come upon you. You don't know when you're going to need to know this information. So you had better, you know, go at it rapidly and diligently with urgency. This is what Jesus was imparting. Take it seriously. And don't let the yeast of egoic speculation enter into the situation. This is very important. As I've shared with everyone, we must not get cornered by the ego, into conceptually cornered. So we need to do assertions, okay? Assertions, flipping the script, assertions, full stop in the wow. Do not allow the ego to even get a foothold in what you're doing. This would be the yeast, which would then cause the bread to get all bubbly and airy and rise this way and that way, and it takes a while. It's all puffed up with confusion, with all these bubbles and confusion, whereas the unleavened bread is very simple, plain, solid. So don't let the ego get into the discussion. Don't have a discussion where the ego starts, you know, pestering you, which it will do ceaselessly if you allow it. So take this both and neither stance. Yeah, I'm both listening to your ego and not listening. So take this completely ambiguous stance as far as the ego, so the ego cannot get any foothold on that. And so this is the other aspect. This is very important, and the wine symbolized the wow factor. So he was just pointing out how to practice is what he was really doing. But Christianity, following Cyril of Alexandria's lead, ultimately brought the communion wafer in as this magical hypostatic union principle, where it's actually the belief that Jesus' body was both human and divine hypostatically one. And therefore, the priest had some way of transforming that into the body of Christ. Eating that, you're then getting this mystical hypostatic union that'll give you eternal life, which is really Egyptian teaching. All right, it has nothing to do with what Jesus taught at all. Jesus was way, way wiser than that, and understanding that we've never been diverted from the truth of our being. It's all pretense. What God creates cannot be changed. So, you know, it's been a side trip. We've been on a side trip. Much of the world's been on side trips. And we just have to realize that and say, okay, it's a side trip. And just say, it's okay. It's okay that I was on some side trips. I never deviated from the truth of my being one bit. I can't. I cannot. We cannot deviate from eternal life. We don't have to regain eternal life. We just have to assert we've never left it. Never left it. This is what's so important. If you must assert the truth of your being, rather than be getting caught in a dialectic with the ego, like, well, how do I get back? I lost my eternal life. No, we didn't lose anything. The same way that someone doesn't lose their identity by pretending to be somebody else. And the ego, basically, this is how crazy the ego is. The ego tells us, like, hold your breath, try to practice this. So holding my breath, you know, and then the ego says, okay, in order to get oxygen, you say, well, I'm running out of oxygen. So the ego says, okay, but in order to get oxygen, you have to keep holding your breath. You say, oh, really? Okay, keep holding breath. Okay, I need oxygen. So the ego says, okay, you're almost there, but in order to get oxygen, you must keep holding your breath. Obviously, this is the ego's advice. Obviously, that's how you don't get oxygen. So the ego tells us that how to get eternal life is we must continue to pretend to be dead. And once we finally die, then we'll gain eternal life. This is what the ego is teaching us. The problem with this is we can't die. So that's a big problem. So in other words, the ego's advice is useless to us, entirely useless. But yeah, imagine just holding your breath and then say, okay, the only way to get oxygen is just keep holding my breath. And realize that's how crazy the ego is. Even more crazy than that. But that's a good example of it. Let's see if we can get through to the Donald again. Okay, busy guy. Talking with a lot of people. A lot of press. A lot of... I'm surprised I got through three times. Yeah, I really do have I do have a cell number on speed dial, absolutely. I think he'll be changing it though. So we're finding out a lot here. A lot of the rituals, the creeds, rituals, a lot came from Egyptian religion. And keep in mind that the Greeks took over Egypt. Okay, we must understand this, that Egypt had thousands of years of history. It was the great civilization, along with the Vedic civilization, but the Egyptian civilization, I mean, just the scale of everything they did, they knew stuff. And they were there for thousands of years, writing down their history, and which is stored in the Library of Alexandria. So Greece, with Alexander the Great, took over Egypt, and Greek settlers. What Alexander the Great did is he caused immigration. Greeks emigrated from Greece, from Macedonia, from Thrace, from various places, and he sent them to his new cities. He built new cities and then sent people there to live there. This is what he did. And so these people, intellectuals, and they wanted to be the greatest capital, they wanted to be the greatest city in the world, the world's ever known. He wanted it to be the absolute cornerstone of his greatness. So he sent a lot of intellectuals and great artists and everyone who was very, very skilled to live in Alexandria. So these people were very bright and very inquisitive. The Greeks were very inquisitive. They're very much into history, studying history. So of course they studied the history of Egypt. They were experts on it. And they had the writing. They had the evidence. They had all of that there. So you've got to believe that. And then of course Rome defeated Greece, and then Rome took over. Octavian took over, they took over Egypt. And then, so Rome ruled Egypt as a province then. And so they found out too. They found out about all this and the mixture of the Greco-Roman Empire. All of what they found out from Egypt, ancient history of Egypt, they put a lot of that into the Roman Catholic Church. The rituals, the costumes, the symbolism, the ankh, you know, the shepherd's staff. There's the ankh. There's a massive amount of Egyptology, Egypt symbology and everything that was used, including the Egypt's favorite icon of Egypt was the Madonna, mother and child, Isis and Osiris, I believe. That was all over the Greco-Roman Empire. It was ubiquitous. Keep in mind that the Greeks... many lived in Egypt, okay, and they were spread out throughout the whole Greco-Roman Empire, the Hellenistic world. They traveled a lot, and this, you know, these symbols spread all over the empire, Greco-Roman Empire. They were everywhere, and the most prevalent one was the Madonna that we see now, the mother and child. That came from Egypt, absolutely came from Egypt. And when Christianity was made the official religion by Constantine, they eventually came to destroy all pagan idols and symbology throughout the empire. That was the edict, except for one, and the Madonna and Child was not destroyed. It was left intact throughout the empire. And so we have this Mary worship, which Cyril was very heavily a Theotokos, a Mother of God advocate. There were a lot. This was very, very prevalent. So the symbology of ancient Egyptian religion really spread throughout that whole entire area, the massive empire. And so that got incorporated into the central fabric of Christianity. It's Egyptian. So the Eucharist is Egyptian, Madonna and Child is Egyptian, the worship of Mother Mary, Mother of God, is Egyptian, Theotokos, that's all Egyptian. And the cradle of Christianity, you might say, is Alexandria, actually. You know, even though, like, Rome eventually had more population than Alexandria, at some point, but still, you know, Alexandria was like you know, the cultural, intellectual center of the known world that was known by them at that time. We can talk about the, you know, the Indus civilization also, but for our purpose, we're talking about the Greco-Roman Empire and Christianity. So, you know, it's like sort of like, you know, Los Angeles compared to New York, or, you know, something like that, sort of a newer city, but the culture, the history and the culture, and the libraries and museums, you know, that was in Alexandria. So they had the heavy, heavy, heavy clout and influence, and they won the Council Chalcedon, and put in the Chalcedonian Creed, and got that agreed upon. And it's heavily influenced by ancient history of Egypt and the practices, Greco-Roman synthesis, the synthesis of the Talmud, of the Torah, and the Jewish religion, its teachings of Moses, synthesized with Greek philosophy, with a heavy context of Egyptology, Egyptian tradition, ritual, esoteric beliefs and understanding. All this stuff, again, was available to the scholars in this massive library at Alexandria. Which Alexander, the purpose was to house all the knowledge, ancient knowledge of the world. Alexander the Great, you know, wanted this to be the center of the world, Alexandria. And so whatever he discovered, wherever he was, and he was on a mission to gather all the knowledge of the world, you know, and put it into museums and libraries and make it available to everybody. In some ways, he was very farsighted. The Greeks are very farsighted in a lot of ways. We still follow that pattern in a lot of ways. So they did collect all the known knowledge in the world that they could, and it was stored in a library, and they did have scholars from all over the empire go there and study. So these people were quite learned. The bishops, you know, this is another thing, the bishops, the learned people of the ancient age, these people were very learned. A lot of them were scholars. I mean, you didn't become a very high bishop, one of the apostolic sees, unless you were very, very brilliant and learned. And so Christianity developed from this in this situation. We think that, oh no, just the saints were in charge of everything, those who have humble, you know, love and listen to the Holy Spirit. No, that's not really how it really happened. It's those learned scholars of who had, you know, who spoke, you know, Greek and ultimately Latin later, and had studied in places where this knowledge was kept. People say, well, Caesar burned down the Library of Alexandria. I don't think so. It may have been damaged a little bit, but I think that it burned down later. But still, there was a lot of knowledge permeating the time, ancient knowledge, actually. This is what we don't realize. they had their hands on the ancient knowledge history of the world. The people of that time, the scholars, the learned people, had their hands on this information. Information that we don't even have now. It was lost when the library was finally destroyed. That was lost. You know, and some of it maybe was kept on in esoteric symbolic traditions in various ways. Who knows? Maybe the Knights Templars had some of it somehow, or you know. But it got lost, and now we're sort of rediscovering it in archaeologically and sort of spiritual archaeology. But they had their hands on it, so they had their idea of what they want religion to be like. A lot coming from this ancient history and ancient practices. But from what I gather, Jesus has a different teaching. He brought a New Testament that says none of that stuff matters at all, actually. And if we read A Course in Miracles now, Jesus says this is the true, my real teaching. It has nothing to do with any of that ancient knowledge, really. So the Christianity that we have had for several thousand years is basically the ancient teachings and ancient knowledge is sort of using Jesus as a way to sell it to us, you know, as a figurehead of it, with a very heavy component of Mary, the Mother of God, and the Eucharistic hypostatic union, mystical union, that supposedly this is going to eventually get you to have eternal life, and all of this. This is what we've been getting. This and Jesus' teachings that we're hearing now, it's like, wow, he just basically treats that all as a side trip. Doesn't even reference it, basically. There's really no esotericism in anything he says. He just says we're just, basically, he says we're pretending to be dead. I mean, those are my words. This is how I synthesize it. But in so many words, this is what he's saying. It's all a pretense. It's all a dream. It's all our imagination. We're absolutely free. We cannot deviate from our true being one bit. We are eternal life right now. We always have been. We're just like having a dream, dreaming that we're dying. We're subject to death. We're not. Now, there are many ways to emphasize, and so you can't put all ways into a book because then it would just be too confusing. So you have to at least have some line of emphasis to get momentum going. But once you get the momentum going, then the Holy Spirit can help you keep shifting your emphasis better and better and better. So when I say that we're all pretending to be dead, this is a very high level of emphasis, very basic, and it was very difficult to get to this. But again, it's like holding our breath. We're holding our breath, no oxygen, no oxygen, no oxygen. Oh, I need oxygen. Oh my gosh. And the ego says, no, no, no. You'll get it if you just hold it a little longer. And basically, we can synthesize all the advice of the ego as basically saying, as a parallel, saying just pretend to be dead a little longer, and then you really will be dead. That's it. In a nutshell, that's all the ego ever says. Just pretend a little longer. That's all it ever says. Now, it coats it. It's like wallpaper. Puts all this wallpaper on the wall. But basically, the wall is just sheetrock. And you can paper a wall with, you know, how many different wallpaper patterns they have. It's just almost endless. Right? But what's beneath the thin wallpaper? Sheetrock, you know. Right, or stucco, or plaster, whatever you want to, right? Wood paneling, but it's just construction material, cheap construction material. So the ego, it doesn't matter how it says it, it will use any words that we will accept. Whatever we'll accept, the ego will use those words, whatever it is. And which is why we have all this variety, you know, like people have all different labels and ways. The ego will say whatever we will accept to just basically say, wait a little longer. Keep pretending to be dead a little longer. Hold your breath a little longer. Then you'll get the oxygen. So keep pretending to be dead. And then once you actually die, then you'll be reborn. Okay, this is what the ego tells us. That's it. Nothing more than that. So it's not really listening. It's not really dialoguing. It has set advice, and its advice is always exactly the same. It never deviates from it at all. It just uses whatever words and concepts that you're willing to use. It searches for your willingness of, okay, well, how do you want me to say this? You want me to say it this way? Okay, I'll use these words. So it seems like there's all this dialogue going on and difference and changes and everything. The ego never changes its position at all. Never. It's completely fixated forever on this, just pretend a little longer. That's all you need to do. And I've been aware of this my whole life. I was aware of the ego coming back in this world. And the ego says, you just got to do one more life. And then I said, okay, I've done it, but it's terrible. I said, well, just wait a little longer. Every day the ego just says, just wait a little longer. You're almost there. You're almost dead. You almost have a authentic death here. Just wait a little longer. It never deviates from that, actually. So it's really not saying anything other than that. So we don't need to listen to the ego at all. We know what it says, what its position is. And it's cut and dried. Its position is so cut and dried, there's no reason to discuss it at all. Okay, it says just wait a little longer, and then you'll be authentically dead. What else can it say but wait a little longer? Since it never can happen, what else can it say but wait a little longer? That's all it can say. It has no other position. That's it. Nothing else other than that. So the more we can accept this, that the ego is really that simple, it's really that simple, the better off we will be to see that simplicity. He says, wow, wait a little longer. Oh, well. Okay. It's nonstop. I don't know how I got through. It's nonstop. That's fun. It's good fun. We should call up Jesus. I doubt that he has a phone, though. Doesn't need a phone. Truth is very simple. The ego's only saying, wait a little longer, and then you'll finally really die. I said, ego, I feel so dead all the time. My gosh, my whole life I feel so utterly dead. He said, you mean it's this is an authentic death? I said, no, it's not quite yet. Just one more day and you'll be authentically dead. I said, oh gosh, okay. I don't know if I can wait that long. And it's never changed its advice. It can't. So we don't need to be trying to figure out how to change the, you know, what the ego's saying. We don't have to try to figure it out. We now know exactly what its position is. And of course, Jesus' position is very simple. It says you can't die. You cannot change what God created cannot be changed. This is ego's. This is Jesus' simple position in contradistinction to the ego's simple position. Both are very simple. Both are diametrically opposed, right? They're diametrically opposed. They cannot both be true. The ego says, wait a little longer, and you so certainly you'll have authentic death. Of course, it's possible. You will do it. Just wait a little longer. Jesus says, you cannot die. It's absolutely impossible. It doesn't matter how long you wait. It will never happen. What God created can never be changed. And so you are eternal life exactly as God created you. This is Jesus' position. This is the position of the Holy Spirit. And the ego's position is diametrically opposed to that. Both can never be true. We cannot join them. There is no hypostatic union between those two positions. It's impossible. So the entire Chalcedonian Creed is saying that there's this hypostatic union, and the Eucharist is saying that you're actually participating in the hypostatic union. Yeah. You cannot have any union of those two positions at all. And of course they say, well, it's a mystery, because we don't know how it's possible. Well, I got news. It's not possible. That's what we know. We know it's not possible. Of course, they're saying, well, that's the only way. We got to have both those positions. No, we don't. No, we don't. And they say, well, what about God's creation? What do you mean? Bodies are not God's creation. Okay, the world is not God's creation. They say, well, of course, who else could do it? Well, we did. It's our dream. It's the dream. It's the props we're using to make it seem like we're authentically dead. Right? How come? It's like, how do we dress spirit up to make it look authentically dead? We'll put a body in a world, you know, to put a body in a world of impermanence, and then spirit will say, wow, really looks like I'm really dead, doesn't it? Like that. How do you make someone look slim? Dress them up in a black suit, you know, black clothing, right? They look slimmer. I had a black shirt on, so I was, why are you lost weight? I said, actually, no, I haven't. I'm just wearing this baggy black shirt. It's going to make you disappear. So what we've done is we've imagined this world and bodies, and then we think, wow, this is very convincing. And we're trying to convince this imaginary guilt, which we say, well, how do we judge that we've died? Well, there's a judge that's not us. It's not God, and it's not us. And when we die and God dies, there's still this judge that can judge that we indeed managed to die, and therefore we killed God, and therefore our will is greater, therefore we deserve to be resurrected as prime creator. We've invented this separate power or something. It doesn't exist at all. So here we are, trying to be authentically dead, and we have these props called a world and bodies that they're just props to make it seem like, you know, we're authentically dead. That's all it is. We don't need any hypostatic union, whatever that's supposed to mean. A dream is just a dream. We don't need to join the dream with the dreamer, and like there's two the dream is separate from the dreamer. You have a dreamer and a dream that's separate from the dreamer. Now, how do we get those together and make it one union here in a new creation where both the dreamer and the dream are separate natures, and yet they're hypostatically one? And well, that's absurd. You just wake up from the dream. You know, they had it completely wrong. Got it completely wrong. So they weren't experts on Jesus' teachings, actually. These heavyweight political figures, when they were political figures, let's keep this in mind, that these leaders of these very important ancient cities, Antioch, Constantinople, Rome, Damascus, Alexandria, Ephesus, various places, they were very politically connected and powerful and learned, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And they were very learned in, like Cyril. No, that was Philo. Philo had a lot of influence on early Christian thought, because he was one of the most important philosophers of that Jesus's time, and that became very famous and popular. He said that, you know, all truth came from the Old Testament. They had a Septuagint in Alexandria, the translation of the Hebrew Bible, and he said all truth comes from that. And so this was very prevalent among the empire, that all truth, you know, the Philo's philosophy, that Greek philosophy came from the teachings of Moses, and all of it, all truth comes from that, and. And then there's various blends of all this stuff. This is what these people believed in. These heavyweight people, that's what they believed in. They didn't know Jesus' teaching, really. This didn't form a large part of their education or understanding. I mean, there wasn't a vacuum. Jesus didn't come into a vacuum of tabula rasa, of a blank slate, where he just, you know, wrote the truth into people's minds. The people of that time were not just these vacuous minds. They were sophisticated people, actually, with tremendous histories of religious thought and speculation and all sorts of theories. And so there was no blank mind that Jesus just came and said, okay, let me just tell you the truth. People said, oh, great, that's it. I can see that's the truth. Thank you. It wasn't like that at all. There's no such situation that ever existed for Jesus, not at all. Now, he picked the apostles among just fishermen, and I mean, there was the tax collector, right? Levi, tax collector, Matthew became, but you know, just Galilean fishermen and farmers and various things who were not so learned, you see, who are not so learned actually. Just salt of the earth, blue collar, just catching fish. That's who the apostles were. And although the evangelist Luke was not one of those. He was not one of the apostles. He was a doctor, and he was maybe more learned than the others. But the people that Jesus, the apostles, were not scholars. Whereas the bishops and later on, the heavyweight leaders of the Christian church, they were scholars. They were intellectuals. They were politicians. Very different than the apostles. And they were full of doctrines, as were the sophisticated intellectual Jews. Or a lot of the Jews were very learned about Judaism, and so there was not this. So how does Jesus get his truth through in such a situation and have it everyone clearly understand it and say, okay, this is the teaching? It didn't happen. And only now, with A Course in Miracles, actually are we getting a much clearer picture of what Jesus' real teachings are. And Journey Beyond Words is again a stupendous clarification of what Jesus' real teachings are. And for me, these resonate very, very clearly. And say, wow, the cohesiveness is just extraordinary. It's just absolutely extraordinary. Of course, using words and concepts, etc., there's always seems to be some wiggle room, but the wise in your wisdom and looking at it, you say, I see that. I'm not going to make a level confusion, mistake or something. That you to emphasize something, sometimes it leaves sort of a gray area here in order to do this. And you can't be perfect in using words to as far as emphasis goes. So it's still not easy to use words to get a truth, but the cohesiveness of his teaching is extraordinary. There's no funny business in there at all. It all fits. So, and we don't have blank minds right now either, do we? We're full of various ideologies. We're also full of a lot of laziness. Now, some of us call it procrastination, but we think, well, if we just procrastinate long enough, and then we won't have to do it, and we won't say, well, it's not laziness. I wanted to do it. I just had procrastinated. Now, procrastination is laziness, actually. We try to use a euphemism called, procrastination, but it's laziness. And so we're very lazy, extraordinarily lazy. I think the ancient people were less lazy than we are now. We're really lazy. People back then were actually quite eager and full of zeal for learning and philosophy, a lot of them. We don't have that now. We're fat, we're lazy, we're slow, we're like, I don't find the will burning in people. I don't find that zeal of let me go after the truth. It just doesn't exist. I haven't been able to come across it in very rare cases here, really. Just it's not happening. It's very surprising, shocking, actually. I'm putting out a lot of information and a lot of materials that can be used as tools for people who really have a burning desire to get to the truth, but it's just not being utilized. The wills aren't there. We just sit back and drink our wine and watch something on TV or a movie or something and think we're very sophisticated. Look at that movie we watched. A bunch of special effects. Wow. I don't know what people do. I mean, I guess they take vacations. Try to pretend to be sophisticated is basically what we do now. Have barbecues, parties, basically waste our lives, waste our time. Where is the zeal? So for me, I had this enormous zeal, enormous that no matter what anyone else is doing, I was like totally focused and furiously studying, I was able to carry this through my whole life. But now it's extraordinarily difficult to have that kind of zeal. I don't know how I did it. I was just absolutely, on fire, and still am. But the wow of it all, sometimes it causes me to be rather subdued, because just the strain of saying all this, you know, getting this information out, lifting the veil, is very tiring and taxing and difficult. But I mean, I just I never stop, you know, reading this, reading this, reading this, getting this, looking at this, studying that, considering this. Non-stop. Entire life like that. Never stop. What is the truth? I have to find it today. You know, I have to find the truth today. It's if I don't, you know, I'm ruined. I've got to find it today. That this is the attitude. So it was like, at all costs, I have to discover it today. And this has been, you know, continual feeling at all costs. But where is that zeal? You see, this is the question. Where is that zeal? Well, the ancients had a lot of that zeal. They traveled a lot. They moved around a lot. They relocated. They searched for this, searched for that. It was commendable. And what they, you know, what they did, just because of the energy that they put forth and all this, we've taken it for gospel, even though it isn't really gospel, because of just the enormous dedication and energy they put into it. But these people, ancient people, were tough. The ones that survived were tough survivalists. They built these massive cities. And ships and commerce. And I mean, they were active. Very, very active. They built all these, you know, churches and monasteries and set up these administration. They built all these roads. They built the aqueducts. I mean, they were building, doing, action. And determined, very determined. Enormous energy and resolve, and very fearless in a lot of ways. And so, just the sheer ambition has come down to us, and us in our kind of lazy, indolent, slothful, materialistic, mindset, we kind of just feel like, wow, you know, we just have to go along with this because it must be true because they set it all up. It kind of overwhelms us, and we look at the everything that we've done in the past, and it's just like, wow, they must have known the truth. They're so on fire with energy. But keep in mind that the lifespans are so much shorter that a lot of their lives were basically live full tilt. You know, a lot of lives were just full tilt all the way, and then maybe die when they're 40 or 50 before, you know, set the decline set in. So they really, I mean, the people who lived into their 60s and 70s were venerable, and 80s, that's super venerable. And they call them, oh my gosh, super learned, as if, you know, they've been on fire for 80 years and must be super learned. So they did not have a culture like we have now, where there's so many people who are slowing down. Once you hit over 50, you start slowing down. And then you get to 60, start then having all sorts of infirmities, and you can feel, you know, your body breaking down, etc. And so we have this whole culture of older people who are, you know, tired, slowed down, don't have the zeal and all this. They didn't have that back then. So we have this disconnect with the longer lifespan. Our lifespan's almost double what they had back then. The people, again, back then, you start out, hit the ground running from 0 to 40, you know, you're go, 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 go. I mean, let's take on the world. You know, you're in a hurry. I say, let's set up this religious order. I mean, they threw themselves into it, and every day was they went big every day. And this is what everybody did. And then you get over 50, 40, 50, you're dead. So there never was this slowed down, lazy culture that we have now. So just the vitality that we feel from ancient times, we mistake that, thinking that, wow, they must have been really on fire with truth. They were on fire with youth. Okay? Not with truth, but with youth. Fire not with truth but with youth. And so it's that fire that we mistakenly think, you know, well, they must have been on fire with truth. Not so. And there was just this continuous turnover. I mean, the wealthy men, the wealthy people, the men married late and the women married early. Among the wealthy classes, early teens for the women and the mid-20s for the men, basically. And for poor people, it was more late teens and for women and later 20s for men, actually something like that. It was different for the poor people. It was different. But for the rich people, the women who 13, 14, early teens, and started having children. By the time they were 20, they've had, you know, five, six children, maybe. I mean, that's how fast. Imagine, you know, mothers that already had, by the time 20, have already had five children. And the children are growing up, and by the time the mother's 40, you know, her children already have children. She's already a grandmother many times over at 40. And then maybe she lives to be 45 or 50. And then that's it. But, you know, imagine the vitality of these people. They have children, but they're still only 20 years old. They got a ton of energy, a ton of ambition. So the ancient world was very ambitious. We don't understand this. When we have, half the world population is over, well, what is it, 30? I mean, it's a half and half or something. But you have, a lot of elder people now in the world who don't have this ambition. This was not true in the ancient times. There was no such class of people, really. If you were an elder, you're held in awe. Like, wow, this is very rare. This is why we hear the stories of someone, we're going to go visit this monk, very elderly monk, very venerable monk, and the young people are going to see this monk. It's like, wow, this is really important. Here's someone who happened to live to be like in their 70s, you know. And like they were like, wow, I've never seen a person who was 70 years old before. This is how it was back then. You didn't often see old people. Like if someone's 80, this is like super rare. How did someone get to be so old? They must have been blessed by God. They must be special to be. So just the very fact of living a long time gave venerability to people. They must be specially blessed by God, which then that also gave them some, a lot of authority. And the younger people would, with all their enthusiasm, say, "Well, tell us the truth. Tell us." And then they try to pass on something and say, "Okay, that must be the truth because you're 80 years old, and you couldn't have been that way unless you knew the truth." And then they push this teaching forward, which really was just because someone was really old, wasn't really truth. So remember that there was not this older class of that we have now, because of our medicine, everything that we have modern age, where now people would say, well, I'm going to live to be at least 80, you know, maybe 90. I mean, what do most people expect? They can live to be definitely into your 80s, right? I think women live 7 years longer than men on the average of the States. So a lot of them think, well, you know, probably 90-something. Get hip replacement, knee replacement, various things, you know, and hang on to about that age. Back then, you know, no, it was like maybe 45 would be, considered a good long life. Half, half. They had not lost their energy and zeal. After you hit 45, you know, it's downhill. And so you just, you know, you don't have that go zeal. You just don't. So this warps our understanding of history to an extreme extent. Wow, this sink in. It's huge. You realize, well, we have not really understood . We think the people writing these books and doing stuff in the past were in their 60s, their 70s, like the scholars, you know, the universities. No, they weren't. How old were the apostles, you know, when they're sent out? Late 20s, 30s, maybe. And they went go, and the crucified, what, in their 40s, 50s? Or, you know, they didn't last long. John did. I mean, he was a rare exception. Isle of Patmos, maybe lived into his 80s, and he was seen to be an extraordinarily venerable because he lived so long. His teaching was seemed to be somewhat similar to Philo's teaching about the Word and the flesh and all this kind of Word made flesh. And Philo's the one that believed that you know, all philosophy, all truth comes from teachings of Moses. And John's teachings sounds pretty similar in a lot of ways. So again, we conflate authenticity with youth, with just the vigor and zeal and ambition and determination. And we think, wow, they're on fire with the Spirit. They're on fire with youth. Just like I was. When in my youth, I was nonstop studying. I didn't let anything stop or deter me. I'm still doing it, but it's not easy. It was not on fire with truth. It was on fire with youth. And as we get older generations, we're kind of like awed by the past, like, wow. You know, they must have known something really authentic. No, they didn't. I guarantee you that A Course in Miracles is immeasurably more authentic than anything that they had back then. But they had all these vigorous debates, you know, and politicking, and so it seemed real vivid and dramatic, and they, you know, they pushed this through and built this, and that, you know, I mean, look at Alexander. How old was he when he died? I don't even think he reached 30. He conquered the entire known world, basically, except for India. He came to an end there, and of course didn't know about China so much, although they did. I'm sure that there was back and forth with China, even at that time in India. But the people were always traveling and trading, actually. Silk Road, I don't think it was so established at that point, but still. So, I think he was under 30 when he died. Maybe he was 30. Something like that. That's it. But look what he accomplished by the age of 30. Conquered, then, you know, the quote-unquote known world. Built, how many cities did he build? Just a huge number of cities. Set up this new administration. I mean, he did so much in 30 years that every day must have been just like a colossal day. He may have rarely ever slept or stopped at all. So this huge world empire by the age of 30, and then he died. This is how it went. I mean, these conquerors were young people, a lot of them. So it was the age of youth. Youth. Pushing stuff through. Pushing change. Push this, push this, push this, push this, push this. So all that got pushed, and ultimately it all ends up being pushed onto us here now, as we're able to sort through all this. But again, they never had anything as authentic as A Course in Miracles. So we're way ahead of the game, actually, even though we may be older. Way ahead of the game. But all of that ambition and everything that did has basically been all pushed down to us now, and we're like, it's like a landslide, like, wow, we're like buried in it. The ambition of youth. We're buried in the fallout from the ambition of youth, which is quite impulsive. It inherently tends towards the dualism of human and divine, because you're on fire with the flesh and the impulses and ambitions that have been projected onto the flesh, and so you have a very difficult time even considering that all this is just a dream, a play. And it's not real. It has no existence in itself. This world has no existence in itself whatsoever. Neither does the body. That's straight from Journey Beyond Words from Jesus. Yeshua, however you want to call it. Jesus' Hellenized version of Yeshua.